Thank you, all of you. Good morning, everybody. Dr. Lungu is sitting over there. He will join us very soon because he is also taking part of this presentation. Dr. Lungu is a surgeon. He is working in Malawi. He's got a huge experience. Not only he has worked in a mission hospital, he worked as a general doctor in a district hospital. He became a surgeon. He was going back, started to work in one of the hospitals. He was also a politician for a while because he was the director of clinical services in Malawi. So you can ask him all political questions to him. He will answer them. And now he's working in a central hospital. So thank you very much, Douglas, that you came all the way from Malawi to here to give our presentation on the job training, from on the job training towards a Bachelor of Science degree course for clinical officers in Malawi. During the day, the years, the title of this presentation has changed. I first started to tell about on the job training, but gradually it moved to something else, and I will tell you why. Yes, this is Malawi. It is not Mali. Quite a number of people still think that where I work is Mali, but no, I cannot tell them that it is not Mali, and after 6 months or I see them again, they still think that it is Mali, but it is not Mali, it is Malawi. And that country is there. And you have seen that already in the picture of Henning. This is Malawi on the left side, some region, and the clinical officer training took off in the southern region. This is the city, Blantyre, where the College of Medicine is seated and the Department of Surgery. Then you know where it is. And then later on, it moved to the northern region. This one? Push? Right. The other one? Oh, okay. So, just a little information about Malawi. When I came to Malawi in the 70s and worked in a mission hospital, there were only 6 million people. There are now 16 million people in my absence, so it's going very, very fast, and everyone knows that it is still going on, doubling the number of people in 15 to 20 years, so count your blessings. Malawi is the 9th poorest country of the world. Your country, Matthijs, Congo, is the poorest. The Netherlands is the 9th richest. And 11% of the HIV patient, of the population, is HIV positive. So there's quite a lot of people. There is only one doctor for 50,000 people. There are very few Malawian specialists. Dr. Lungu is one of them. And there is the brain drain. Maybe you have seen some years ago from CNN, and that was the deadly brain drain in Malawi, and that was called, there are more Malawian doctors in Manchester than there are in Malawi. So when I returned to Malawi and I asked them, what can I do? The Department of Surgery, Professor Borgstein, asked me, could you train clinical officers? And why did he ask me? Because there was investigation done in all district hospitals. That was nearly 30,000 operations, and only 3% of them was on surgery. So, yes, clinical officers, we know about them. They are the backbone of healthcare in Malawi. The training of clinical officer is basic. It's only 3 years and then 1 year internships in district hospitals. And due to the lack of surgical skills, they sent the patients to the central hospitals. As a consequence, these hospitals become overloaded and patients have to wait and die sometimes. So that's why we were thinking to start a specific training for clinical officers, and it was on the job. I didn't want to sit in one hospital to train clinical officers. I wanted to go to them. And why on the job, Dr. Lungu will tell that, but one of the reasons was not to take these clinical officers out of their hospitals and to reduce even more the number of health workers in these hospitals. But there are more, Dr. Lungu will tell them. And the program we developed was 2 years for two selected clinical officers per hospital. And first, as I told you, in the southern region, then in the northern region. Altogether, we trained 45 clinical officers in 17 in the southern region, 11 in the northern region, in about 28 mission and district hospitals. Quite a number. And the goal was, well, to train them in obstetric knowledge and surgical knowledge, to care for trauma patients. There are a lot of trauma patients, and to let them doing it safely, which is a challenge as well, and to standardize the protocols in these hospitals, because we have, as Henning told, there were quite a number of German surgeons, there were British surgeons, there were Dutch surgeons, and there were other hospitals. They all thought, well, our protocol is better than the other one. And sometimes there was no protocol at all. So there were so many different protocols, and we tried to standardize these protocols. And the last option was less referrals to the central hospitals. The teaching programs in 2 years, hospital visits, but then for a week, once in a while, for attachment training, for further training, specifically those what could not be trained by the surgeon at his hospital visits. And there is a lot of things to do, but you see also on the ENT, on the ophthalmology, the surgical aspects of them. And the teachers then were College of Medicine people in the city of Blantyre. And the hospital visit, the training program is structured. It is not just to see a few patients and to ask which one needs an operation and to go to the... No, there is a 2 days, 1 to 2 days program in the morning, afternoon, and in the second day, let's go and have a view what we were doing. So first of all, in the morning, we went to the OPD, and we saw selected cases by the clinical officers. They had to present this patient with a plan, like an academic situation. They had to make a differential diagnosis, etc. Then I just wanted to show you a few slides. It is maybe good for all those youngsters who have not been yet in the tropical area to be aware what they could see when they are going to these hospitals. I'm not going into details, that is, we do not have time to do that, but now you see, probably you see that, two hernias. So for you to think about it when you go home, which one actually would you operate? And this patient was presented as a cancer patient, but really, is it? Do you think, look to the picture, look to the axilla, is it breast cancer, or maybe in your differential diagnosis, it could be something else? And we were, in the afternoon, we went to the wards, and we wanted to see all patients, not only the ones who were presented by the clinical officers, maybe hiding the ones who were not really doing well. And the clinical officer, again, had to show all these patients. He had to know all those patients. And we were there to use the patient as a bad teaching patient. So again, a few patients in the wards. What is this? What will you do about it? Interesting. Go home with the idea and think what would you do in a case like this. And what would you do in a case like that? That one was presented as a hydrocele, but is it a hydrocele? Maybe it's not. I put my stethoscope in there, not for nothing, because a hydrocele is not making any noise. But if you have a scrotal hernia, you will hear the noise of bowels. And if it is a scrotal hernia, what would you do? And then this is a snake bite. What are the symptoms? What is the danger of a snake bite? What would you do? Trauma care, lots of patients, there are lots of, you see, a traffic accident with so many patients on the car, huge problems. The other day, It starts with teaching for the hospital staff. Then we go to the theater and do the whole day theater cases. And we make use of anesthetic clinical officers. Some are very, very well trained. Some of them are only doing spinal anesthesia, but really that differs. So from one side to another, you might do different things depending on the quality of an anesthetic clinical officer. So this is the standard picture. The surgeon, the two clinical officers, and a Dutch medical student who came along to join us on our trips. And then at the end of the 2 days, we went to the DHO, we talked to him and said, you did very well, but please, could we have more suture material maybe? Better you could close your doors of the theater and et cetera, et cetera. So the next visit, we were checking if all these improvements was really done. Then we had the attachment weeks for extra theory and skills for bowel suturing, because we wanted to train them in handling the acute cases, the life-saving procedures, a colostomy or an ileostomy, or to put a drain in a goat like this, or to drill pins in a fracture, because it's still traction for a dislocated fracture at the district hospitals. And then primary trauma course, and also the training in obstetrical emergencies. And then after 2 years, the program was reviewed by the College of Medicine. And what was the outcome? The clinical officer skills have improved. Patient and hospital benefited. And overwhelming support in and outside Malawi. And who was the first one who came to see us in the Lower Shire Valley? Mina. And she is from the WHO to see what it was all about, this on-the-job training. And later on, there were others, the Bellagio, and there was the African Union who was interested to know, and now recently the European Union. I pushed on the wrong button. all those difficult tools. And this was checked by Professor Barry. Was it really useful? Prove it, if you say so. Well, here we have two results, two studies. And yes, after 1 year of the training, we had already a reduction in the post-operative infection of inguinal hernia patients. Mind you, 21 of all these operations got infected till 8.7%, and study two is 1 year after the 2 years training, it were more major operations. Any more problems? Yes, we had dropout. Why was that? Because we didn't offer a career perspective. We were not allowed to do so. Ministry of Health said, no, we have the doctors. They are more important than the clinical officers. So they left the hospital. They wanted to become hospital administrators. So it took a while, but then we got invited to the Ministry of Health for a big meeting with all the important institutions. And that was the moment, and this is really important, what I told the Ministry of Health from studies from Mozambique. What is it? No difference in surgical outcome between doctors and technical chirurgia in Mozambique, the same as clinical officers. For 1/4 of the training costs, for less hospital costs per patient, for a salary of 1/10 of the doctor, while the technical, the chirurgica stay in the rural hospital and not leave in the country, while all doctors have left district hospitals within 7 years. General opinion, doctors not trained nor skilled for work in rural hospitals. The response was from the Ministry of Health by then, we should have started this program 5 to 10 years ago. And they ordered the College of Medicine to create BSc courses for surgery, obstetrics, medicine, pediatrics, orthopedics, and anesthesia. Dr. Lungu.
Use this one. Okay. Yeah, the good thing about speaking after Peter is that I don't have to speak very much because he's taken up all the time anyway. So I'm Douglas Lungu. I work at this hospital, which is Mzuzu Central Hospital in the north of Malawi. I'm a surgeon. I qualified around 2002, sometime back. I'm actually more or less an accidental surgeon. I don't just do surgery. The reason I did surgery was because I worked at a district hospital in Kasungu in 1995, and the worst thing was to see patients that we could operate on, but I didn't have the skills to do so. So I actually went to an organization and I said, listen, I need money to go and learn how to operate. I don't want to qualify. And they did give me money for 2 years to go and learn how to operate. And I ended up in South Africa learning how to operate. After 2 years, the money ran out. And I felt that I really needed to qualify after that. So I had to find some other ways. But basically, the major constraint in a district hospital is surgery, strangely enough. And without that, sometimes your credibility as a doctor is actually totally undermined. Because you just need to fail on a few things for them to have a problem. The basic things that you need in a district hospital is not that much, but they need to be very systematic. If you are very systematic, I always tell people that the surgery that I'm doing, people were doing in the Western countries in 1940, and they had very good outcomes. So therefore, we can have good outcomes without all the things that go beep, 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 and so on, except the pulse oximeter, of course. So why on-the-job training? Basically, as Peter had indicated, we just didn't want to be able to reduce. If you take people out to go and train, then they don't. There's nobody at the hospital. And one of the things that Mathes, who was just speaking about Zomba, about Malawi, what he didn't say is that there's a lot of training. There's a lot of training. Most of the training actually is not very useful, apart from that you get an allowance every time you go to a training. So most of the time people are out of the hospitals, and that is quite noticeable. So if you can train people on the job, it will help. It also improves the quality of care because there's CPD, and it's not just for those ones that are receiving it, but also for the rest of the clinical staff. So they have got a chance to have a contact with someone with a little bit more experience and also with qualification. So that also provides supervision. You need the hospitals need to be supervised. And if you have a reason to go there on a regular basis and people can understand that you will turn up, it becomes predictable. And therefore, they are less stressed in the sense that they know that at least someone is going to be here at some point and we can ask the questions. If you don't know whether someone is going to turn up one day or not, you're saying, okay, let me pick up a phone, let me call. Sometimes it's not so easy to get advice. But at least if you know that there's a regular someone coming. So the on-job training does help in that. It's also cost-effective, and as Peter had already said, but it also encourages innovations. And that's the other thing that we need to encourage the younger guys coming to low-resource settings. And the wonderful thing about attending conferences like this is that I get to learn a lot about Malawi that I don't know. So you tend to be told a lot of things. Sorry, you are very poor. This is what you do, this is what it is. And you go, oh, yeah, that's what you do? Yeah, thanks. So one of the things that happens when you go out is either, I mean, we had a game we used to play in a rural hospital with one of my friend doctors. And if we have an expatriate coming, the first day they come in, they are shocked. The second day, they want to change everything. The third day, they are frustrated. Okay, it goes into weeks. So some people heal faster, some people take time to heal. So the third time, they are extremely frustrated, they want to go home. And the fourth day, then they come back and say, exactly, how do you manage here? That's when we start working with them. Because at least they've healed. So, yeah. So to some extent, after that, then you need to look around and say, what is it that you can use? And there's usually a whole room somewhere where all the donated equipment goes. And if you can go there, sometimes you can find something that you can make a drain out of, or you can make something else out of it, and so on and so forth. You learn to use all these things. So innovation is extremely important. When you are in that particular place, you know that this can be done. If you can remember the principles by which it happens, you can create it. And if you can create it, that is what those people there will be able to do. And sometimes that's what we learn. We learn quite a lot about wound dressings and stuff like that. And as Peter was showing, this is one of the child who turned up in my clinic once, and I looked at that and I said, wow, this looks like a big sarcoma. And my problem was where to cut this leg. So I had to go to try and work out, you know. So we sent him to a very far hospital to get a CT scan. At the same time, we took a biopsy and we sent it for a biopsy. It turned out to be TB, actually. So we didn't cut the leg off. But also, the other thing that you need to be able to do at this is the effective use of short timers. If you have an already training process going on and you know what you want to train people in, then a short timer who comes in for a week is useful because you know what they're going to teach. And if you don't know what you're going to teach and you just go in, the chances of people learning much from them becomes very, very difficult. As this is a quotation from Benjamin Franklin. He says, tell me and I forget, teach me and I'll remember. But if you involve me in what you are doing, I probably will learn it and I will learn. And therefore, I'll probably be able to remember for a long time. There was a historical moment very recently when we had graduated 64 clinical officers, and they all graduated nicely, and they all have to wear these kind of things. But it's nice. It's nice for the parents to see something like this. That's the only people who get excited with this stuff. So the thing about it is that you have to remember that what we are doing with a certain number of assumptions. And sometimes we forget those assumptions. We make an assumption that we're going to train clinical officers. We make an assumption as to what level a clinical officer can get to. And we make an assumption what happens afterwards. In other words, there is an assumption that there will be some supervision in this. This is not something you send out and you say, this is it. That assumption, sometimes our governments tend to forget it. And it's convenient for them to forget it because it's cheaper to just simply leave it like that. But you need to remind them that the assumption is that there should be some supervision. And therefore, the training of surgeons per se should not be neglected when we do something like this. And it is important that over time we are able to carry these systems together. But lastly, there's kwacha, which basically means the sun is rising. And that's for the CO in Malawi, as well as the benefits of the patient. Thank you.